So hello everyone, good afternoon. So I'm Chandrasil Bhagwat from Mathematics Department, ISER Pune. So I welcome you all on the behalf of the first lecture of the year-long program on triangle groups, Bela uniformization and modularity. The event itself is organized by Vaskaracharya Pratishthan, and we'll hear more about it from the organizers in a minute. So today's lecture is jointly organized by Vaskaracharya Pratishthan and ISER Pune, and then we'll very soon start. So I request all of you who are not speaking to please keep yourself muted and video off so that there is no issue with the bandwidth for everyone. And you can, of course, ask your questions in between on the chat screen, as well as the YouTube audience can ask their questions on YouTube. So now I request Professor S. Katre to tell us very briefly about the whole program, and then after that I will introduce the speaker and we can begin. So over to you, Professor Katre.
Thanks, Chandrasil. Friends, I am S. Katre from SP Pune University and Bhaskaracharya Pratishthan, speaking to you here on the occasion of the first lecture in the series of Prime Minister programs on triangle groups, Bailey uniformization and modularity, which is organized by Bhaskaracharya Pratishthan, which is an institute of mathematics in Pune. This is a year-long program starting from today, that is 1st September 2021, and going up to 31st August 2022, and it will consist of weekly talks. The lectures will be live streamed using Zoom platform, and they will be simultaneously available on YouTube. The organizing committee has planned discussion meetings on Zoom on Saturdays at 7 p.m. for interested participants. In case of any queries, doubts regarding the talks, the participants may send emails to bhaskaraseminar@gmail.com, and these may be discussed in these meetings depending upon the availability of the speaker or other resource persons. On behalf of the organizing committee, I have great pleasure in welcoming all the speakers of the program and the participants consisting of master students, research students, postdocs, faculty members, and others in the field of mathematics. I'm happy that the speakers and participants are from India as well as several other countries, including US, Germany, UK, France, Taiwan, and Australia. And they will take part in various trimesters of the year-long program. Many eminent mathematicians have taken keen interest in the program and have recommended the course of lectures to their colleagues and students. The talks on the 1st and 8th September 2021, they are jointly organized with ISER Pune by the organizing committee members, Chandrasil Bhagwat and Supriya Pisolkar. And the remaining lectures will be on Tuesdays from 7th September onwards. The other members of the organizing committee are Krishnendu Gangopadhyay from ISER Mohali and Jitendra Bajpayee from Bonn. From the beginning, there has been great support for the academic aspects of the program from the advisory board members, namely Professors Ravi Kulkarni, Sujata Ramdurai, Dinesh Thakur, Henry Darman, and John Foyt. The organizing committee is grateful to them for their timely help. The program is being coordinated by Dr. Devendra Tiwari, a postdoctoral fellow at the Bhaskaracharya Pratishthan. And he has put a lot of hard work in the organization of the trimester program by being in constant touch with the advisory board members and the organizing committee members through emails and online or offline meetings. The program is partially supported by National Board for Higher Mathematics through its grant to Bhaskaracharya Pratishthan. And apart from this, there is support from the Indian Mathematics Consortium, RC Foundation from USA, and NASI India or various aspects of the program. We are thankful to these organizations for their generous support. With these words, I welcome you all again and request Dr. Chandrasil Bhagwat to introduce today's speaker, Professor Ravi Kulkarni. Over to you, Dr. Chandrasil.
Thank you, Professor Katre. So we are happy to have our first speaker as one of the distinguished mathematicians from India and who has also worked all over the world, many places, Professor Ravi Kulkarni. So Professor Ravi Kulkarni worked at many US universities over the career of around 30 to 40 years, including Johns Hopkins, Columbia, Indiana, and also CUNY. And then he served as director of the research institute in India called Harishchandra Research Institute. Professor Kulkarni is a leading name in research in geometry and in general mathematics and also mathematics education. He has also served in IIT Bombay as a mathematics chair. And among the other academic activities, he also has contributed a lot by serving as president of the Ramanujan Mathematical Society in India. So we are happy to have him as the first speaker. And now I request Professor Kulkarni to start his talk. So the title of his talk, as you can see on the video, is Topological Underpinnings of the Modular Group. So Professor Ravi Kulkarni, you can unmute yourself and begin the talk. Thank you.
Please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yes, now we can hear you.
Yeah, okay.
Got
it. Yeah, thank you, Chandrasil, for this generous introduction. You know, when Devendra Tiwari first explained the idea to Professor Katre and me, it looked too ambitious. And because we just do not have the necessary expertise in carrying it out. But then Devendra contacted Professor Sujata Ramdurai, Professor Dinesh Thakur, and through them, he contacted many young active researchers in the field and also the research group at ICER Pune, Chandrasil Bhagwat and Supriya Pisolkar. So through the joint efforts, this seminar has materialized now. The seminar touches many areas of mathematics at a foundational level. It has origins in complex analysis, more particularly in the global aspects of Riemann surfaces, particularly compact Riemann surfaces. And if they are non-compact, they are almost close to being compact, namely they are like compact Riemann surface minus a few punctures. And now this area gets connected with the area of the complex algebraic curves, which in a deep way gets connected to number theory. The connection with number theory is via the elliptic curves, that is roughly the cubic curves defined by cubic polynomials in two variables, and then the modular forms, and the famous proof of the Fermat conjecture, and so on. In turn, it gets connected to many higher dimensional extensions. We wish to run this seminar as a workshop at the master's and postdoc level and aim at pointing out various connections and directions. Pursuing any one of these directions will suffice for life's work. So we would also like the speakers to point out some projects which the students can explore. Fortunately, these days we have better computing facilities. So more and more data can be readily constructed to test possible conjectures. So with this, I start my lecture. I wish to give some topological underpinnings of some one complex variable classical topics and a modular group. All these lectures are online. This has a great advantage that one does not have to go somewhere and lecture. or listen to the lectures. But it requires developing a new expertise in presenting the lecture. I have been slow to develop this expertise, especially drawing pictures. Fortunately, Devendra has helped me, and still the slides that I'm going to show may have some errors and inadequacies. I would like to improve on them before you put them on YouTube, if you ever do. Okay, let me begin. Yeah, so here is a brief synopsis of the talk. I shall first explain the idea of the branch coverings, a very general idea, and connect that with the modular curves and the modular group. Then I shall discuss the special theorem of Millington about subgroups of the modular group. And my talk is mainly devoted to give a detailed discussion and proof of this theorem. The original theorem was proved very algebraically, but there are really topological underpinnings everywhere, and by bringing them out, we shall explain this theorem. Okay, the idea of branch covering is a basic idea, which I would say that it concerns the topology of holomorphic functions. Recall that to understand multivalued functions, for example, square root of z or log z, Riemann introduced the idea of a Riemann surface of a holomorphic function. So we associated to a holomorphic function, which is appears to be multivalued, and associated to that a certain surface, which we call the Riemann surface now. This is really a profound merging of the space and number categories of mathematics. At the hands of Poincaré, Klein, Hurwitz, Schwarz, and others, it got beautifully related to discontinuous group actions. The notion went through several stages. Riemann and Poincaré, they did not have a ready-made language to express it, but now with the century's work, we have got that language, and we shall express it better. So to start with the Poincaré's idea of the fundamental group. So let's apply it to the special case of a compact Riemann surface. If X is a compact Riemann surface and X tilde is simply connected cover, then X equal to X tilde mod phi, where phi is the fundamental group, phi 1 X of X, which acts discontinuously on X tilde. Now I would like to draw some pictures. The compact Riemann surface is first of all topologically an orientable two-dimensional manifold, and one of the major theorems of mathematics is that these two-dimensional manifolds are classified really by single number called its genus, and the surface of genus G, you are aware, looks like this, where the G number of holes. Now, if we get a puncture on this, that is the same thing as removing an open disk. Topologically, it is removing the closed disk
It appears to me that the speaker has disconnected, maybe due to some technical issue. Let's wait for a minute.
Are you audible?
We can hear the vendor. You can just press a Kulkarni. Can you try speaking something? Sorry.
Yes. Now.
Yeah, now it's fine. Go ahead. Thanks. Yeah. You have to share the screen. We are not seeing the screen yet.
Yeah. Okay. Let me go back to the screen. My slides. Slides. Now you see, if the genus of this Riemann surface is X, is G, then the fundamental group has the presentation it generated by 2G generators with a single relation, product of the commutators of AI and BI equals 1. And here AI and BI are certain based homotopic classes of certain loops. So let me again draw that by the show it on the picture. So we have the homotopic classes of base loops to define the fundamental domain, but up to conjugacy, we can denote it by such curves. So if I want to have base homotopic classes, then I can choose a base point and join this to each of these curves. And now, if you take the genus 1 case, then this is the torus. And now this is the curve A, and this is the curve B. And now this is the same picture as the usual presentation of a torus as a rectangle with opposite pairs of edges identified. You know, this point is the same as this point, and so this A, you can call this the A curve, so it becomes a circle on the surface, and this is the B curve. And you see these two circles intersect transversely at just one point. Whenever this phenomenon occurs, you can guess that there is a it's really characteristic of getting a genus. You know the Jordan's theorem on the sphere or in R2, any two circles, if they intersect transversely, they will intersect in even number of points, not at a single point. So to detect the genus, we have to have these two intersecting circles at one point. Yeah. Now let me go back to the. Yeah. Now, so this I've explained is AIBI, and now let me introduce this important notion of the branched compact Riemann surface X. So it is the Riemann surface X with the following structure. Specify, I restrict to the compact case for simplicity, it can be extended to the non-compact case in different ways. So specify finitely many points x1, x2, xk on X and attach some natural numbers n1, n2, nk to them. And so denote this object by X sub x1, n1, x2, n2, xk, nk. Its branched fundamental group has a presentation of, if the genus is G, then there are these AI, BI curves as I explained before. And in addition, S1, S2, SK. And then this is the long relation between the generators, the product of the commutators multiplied by the products of the SJs equal to 1. And SJ are elements of finite order, their orders are these integers nj. This SI is a homotopy class of a small loop around XI. Now, one of the very interesting things is, now if I take a XY, any compact Riemann surface, and a non-constant holomorphic map between them. Now, this holomorphic map is always open, and because of compactness, this F will be surjective. And this is one example of a branched covering of compact Riemann surfaces. Now, I shall explain this in more detail. Namely, both X and Y, in addition to its original surface structure, it gets a structure of a branched Riemann surface, and F becomes a holomorphic map between branched Riemann surfaces. More precisely, let script S be the points in P, points in X, for which the derivative of F at P equals zero. Now, F is a map between compact Riemann surfaces to it's holomorphic, and to compute its derivative and to say that it is zero, it is enough to take any local coordinate at P and make the computations there in the standard way. So this set of points is called a singular set in X, and its image in Y is called a branch set. Let me call that beta, and then inverse image of beta by F, let me call that S1, that of course contains S, and S1 is contained in X. Now, in suitable local coordinates, Z at P and W at Q, the map F can be written as F goes Z to W, and W is equal to Z to the N, where N is a natural number, and its intrinsic topological invariant of the map F. That, you see, it's without any conformal or metric considerations, it just shows this point in X goes to that point in Y, that way. Now let's take, now here some number theory starts coming in. Let B sub Q be the least common multiple of these NPQs, where P is, P runs over F1 inverse of Q. Now, P in, attached to P in F inverse Q, the natural numbers, natural number A sub P, which is this LCM of NPQs divided by NPQ. Then X has the branched Riemann surface structure, X with this P comma AP, P runs over F inverse Q and Q runs over beta. And Y gets the branch Riemann surface structure, YQ and B sub Q. Now let gamma be the fundamental group of a pi 1 Y in this structure, and pi the fundamental group of X in this structure. And so that pi becomes a subgroup of gamma. And the topology of the map F can be completely described by the covering projection X tilde mod phi. Both X and Y have the same simply connected cover. And then X is X tilde mod phi, and Y is X tilde mod gamma. And this completely completely topological, this covering projection X tilde mod phi to X tilde mod gamma, that is the complete topological information about the original map F. Now, the study of F is an interesting field in mathematics. If, say, Y is of genus greater than or equal to 2, then there are only finitely many such holomorphic maps. Those are some deep theorems. And these are very special types of maps, and their topology can be studied by introducing these groups. Now, let me take the example. I think the first starting example of mathematics in many ways is the exponential map. So this is a map from complex numbers to complex numbers minus zero, because e to the z is never zero. Now e to the z also is periodic. F of z plus 2 pi I is equal to f of z. Now instead of just saying periodic, on the complex numbers. And now you see, you can restrict this action to the x-axis. What are you doing?
Ask if people are hearing.
Oh, are you hearing?
Professor Kulkarni, in between you, we lost you. So maybe you can just repeat. Can you just repeat the last 1 minute thing again? Oh. There was some disturbance in between.
Yeah, did I explain the branch tree?
Just beginning from the example will be good enough.
Yeah, did you get the branch Riemann surface?
Yes.
An arbitrary holomorphic map.
That's right. Yeah, we got that. Just arbitrary from the example when you were when you started to explain the
surfaces is a branch covering. There are many examples here. Yeah.
Disconnection.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you right now. Professor Kulkarni, can you hear us?
Please unmute Professor Kulkarni.
Professor Kulkarni, you are still on mute. Please click on the unmute.
I have unmuted just now.
Now we can hear you.
Okay, so did you get the concept of a branch Riemann surface?
Right, that branch part was my, Riemann, I think.
Branch compact Riemann surface.
Yeah, you can start with probably this logarithm map and exponential map.
Yes, okay. Now, I take the exponential map. So it maps complex numbers to complex numbers minus zero. So f of z is just equal to z. When you restrict z to the x-axis, I get x goes to e to the x, which is a positive number. So the whole x-axis is mapped onto the positive part of the real axis. Now the curves x equals y equals constant. They will go to rays in C star. And the curves x equals constant, they will go to circles. And the map is now this many to one. And this inverse map is supposed to be the logarithmic function. And we are trying to see what does it mean holomorphically, what that log function is. So what is happening is, it's an inverse in the following sense, that you see that a horizontal strip between y equals pi and y equals minus pi, that already maps surjectively onto the onto C star. And the value at x comma pi is the same as value for x comma minus pi. And so if you take this horizontal strip and identify really topologically y equals pi to y equals minus pi, these two edges, then we get an infinitely long cylinder as an abstract topological space. And from this abstract topological space, we get a map to C star, which is actually one to one, because we have done all these identifications and it needs some proof, but this map is one to one. and its inverse is defined, and it's really the natural log. But this natural log function is going to this abstract space, which is C mod gamma. And from this space, Riemann was talking about constructing the Riemann surface of log Z, and that Riemann surface of log Z is really the original complex numbers. And so this is, in this case, F is in fact a covering map, not a, a branch covering, but this is actually a covering map. Let me take the next example now. Let me take the function Fz equals cos Z. Then we know F of Z plus 2 pi equals Fz, and F of minus Z equals Fz. So this cos Z is invariant under the group gamma defined by Z goes to Z plus 2 pi and Z goes to Z minus Z. Z goes to minus Z. And so this is really a semi-direct product of the group gamma naught generated by Z goes to Z plus 2 pi, the group of order 2, Z2, and Z2 is acting on Z by the obvious semi-direct action. And so, so this is the, this is the infinite dihedral group with some other generators, appropriate generators. It's really a free product of Z2 star Z2. And now on the left hand side, you see the picture. This is my C mod gamma naught. And the middle picture is C mod gamma, where these vertical arrows are identified. And on the x-axis, I have these two segments, minus pi to zero and zero to pi. So zero to pi is identified with zero to minus pi. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear. We can hear.
Okay, so after this identification, this space becomes like a pillow which is open on one side and closed on the other side. And so this pillow is infinitely long. And so this is the image of this, and also this C to C mod gamma. And so this, this image is an example, is a very good example of a branched Riemann surface. Now you see this is topologically just a disk, and even complex analytically, you can consider it complex numbers with two branch points at very particular points, zero and pi. And so with these two branch points, this gets, this gets the your, so we consider C as a branch Riemann surface with branch indices 2 and 2 at point 0 and pi. And then F star is a holomorphic isomorphism between C mod gamma and C. Now here is a grand example, the Weierstrass wave function, which is a meromorphic function on the complex numbers. And the Weierstrass wave function is so if you take gamma naught to be the group generated by Z goes to Z plus 1 and Z goes to Z plus tau, and tau is a tau is not a real number. So this group is isomorphic to Z2, and then this additional group which is isomorphic to Z sub 2, this acts again in a, as a semi-direct product. Now let's look at its topology. So first, C mod gamma naught is this not a rectangle, it is quadrilateral, is a parallelogram. We have to identify the opposite edges in the same orientation. And so with this, after this identification, we get a torus. Z mod 2, non-trivial Z mod 2. To action on the so you see the lower part of this torus, there for every point here there is a point on the top, so its fundamental domain can be considered as this figure shown here. Now the identification here are these two boundary circles where each boundary circle is divided into two segments and they are identified in this way. So you get a closed pillow. And from that, you get a bijection to the two sphere. But that, to make it a, you make SP as a branch, four points of order two. Topologically, it doesn't matter where you get four. These two four points, but to get this particular Riemann surface associated with tau, you have to get this 4 points at some particular values there, if you consider S2 as the standard Riemann sphere. And then you get this holomorphic isomorphism of these branched Riemann surfaces. So these are some examples illustrating what I call the when I introduce the general notion of a branched Riemann surface and every holomorphic map between two compact Riemann surfaces is a branched covering. Now let me come to the modular curves and modular group. The modular curves are the branched Riemann surfaces arising at, and now these are not compact, but with adding a one point, they will become compact. But modular curves are branched Riemann surfaces arising as quotients of the upper half plane H2 by the subgroup phi of finite index in the modular group. Gamma is PSL2Z. To understand the topological issues in the study of modular group gamma, we focus on its action on the hyperbolic plane as a subgroup of PSL2R, which is the orientation preserving isometric group of the upper half plane. So this abstract orientation, the concrete orientation preserving isometric group is identified with this abstract group PSL2R. Now in this group, there is a group PSL2Z, and that group gamma can be generated by S goes to minus one over Z, and T goes to Z plus one. This is some algebraic calculation. And now if you take U equals S times T, so I'm changing the generators of this group, then S is isomorphic to Z2 and U is isomorphic to Z3. And then gamma can be considered as generated by the group generated by S and group generated by U, and it's a free product. And that is our modular group. Now its standard fundamental domain, which all I have seen, is this upper half, in the upper half plane, you draw the arc of the unit circle and take the parallel strip between x equals minus one half and x equals one half. And then the region above the unit circle, that is the fundamental domain. Here I did not denote the identification. The identification on the left edge gets identified with the right edge, and that is the identification by Z goes to Z plus one. And at the center of this, you get that's the point I square root of minus one. that is a fixed point of z goes to minus 1 over z. And that's a 180 degrees rotation around that point. And so this right arc from 0 to this particular point gets identified with 0 to this opposite point. And you can compute the coordinates, etc. I think it is some 1 plus square root 3i by 2, something like that. And so, all these numbers, they become important when you consider number theoretical problems. But this is the standard fundamental domain. And then the modular curve is obtained by gluing these parallel arcs and gluing along this circular boundary component. And here, again, you get the same picture like the picture in cos z, but except that its geometry is vastly different. Here is this angle pi by 2. Here is angle pi by 3. And there are two copies of this triangle with angle pi by 2, pi by 3, and 0. The angle at cusp will be 0. And you get two copies of this and glue along the boundary. And that is this modular curve. Now our connection with the triangle groups, which is the seminar topic. So the modular group is the most important triangle group, I would say. And it is a triangle group 2-3 infinity in the following sense. Let T be a triangle with angles alpha, beta, gamma in spherical, Euclidean, or hyperbolic geometry. Consider the group G generated by reflections in its types. In general, G is not a discrete group. A necessary condition for discreteness of G is the angles. Each of these angles is a rational multiple of pi. This is clear that if it is not a rational multiple, then the group generated by just those two reflections that will contain that's already infinite and the group will not be discrete. So this is a necessary condition. And by the way, we consider the angle to be zero for angle zero is like pi over infinity. Also the triangle with angles pi by p, pi by q, pi by r may not exist in the spherical Euclidean or hyperbolic geometry. For we know that the sum of the angles of a triangle equals pi in Euclidean geometry. It is greater than pi in spherical geometry and less than pi in hyperbolic geometry. This condition translates into 1 over p plus 1 over q plus 1 over r is either equal to 1, greater than 1, or less than 1. Then such triangles do exist. And they exist in these appropriate geometry, and the group generated by reflections in its sides is discrete in the isometric groups of the geometries. And the subgroup of index 2, which consists of orientation preserving transformations in this group, is traditionally denoted by delta PQR, at least I denote it that way, and is called the triangle group of type PQR. In the upper half plane model, you recall, of the hyperbolic geometry, one knows that the geodesics are the vertical lines and semicircular arcs in the upper half plane cutting the x-axis orthogonally. These are the geodesics. And these we take to be the sides of the triangle. So with these remarks and the picture of the fundamental domain of gamma, you see that gamma is a 2-3 infinity triangle group. Now we'll start topology. Now we cut off the cusp, means we take a neighborhood of that point at infinity, and so which is an open disk with a puncture, and then you open disk, which boundary is a circle. And so here is a modular curve with its cusp is cut off. Now, topologically, this is the same as a closed disk with two branch points, 2 and 3. So it's really pure topology now. Now, this disk can be kneaded like a bread and we can concentrate on this branch points of 2 and branch points of 3, and you can create this like a dumbbell type of space topologically we are talking about. Now, the as we observe, the modular group is a free product of Z mod 2 and Z mod 3. Now, what are the subgroups of this? This is our problem. Now, you know, a standard theorem in topology, a subgroup of a free group is free. If the free group with at least two generators is non-abelian, and its subgroups are free with higher number of generators, so it's a very different situation than the subgroups of the purely algebraically, and he got a lot more information there, but the topology is very simple, that you just consider these you just to figure it as a model group, a free one rank two, a finite covering of this is again will contain some circles on the left, some circles on the left, on the right, and some connections in between. And that whole group is the fundamental group of that whole object is like a finite graph, and that fundamental group is free. So just the qualitative information be in a cross type way, you can generalize it to free product of any two groups, let's say G sub 1 and G sub 2. Then what are the subgroups of free product of G1 star G2? So by this thing, you will see that it is a free product of certain subgroups of G1 subgroup G2. I'm taking, say, a finite index. So, and some yeah, okay.
Yes, Professor Kulkarni, you are visible. Okay. Your screen is not visible.
How is it okay?
I can hear you, but your screen has to be shared.
Now, is it okay?
Not yet. We are not seeing the screen yet.
Okay. 45
minutes over. These are the drawbacks.
Devendra, is there an issue with the? Yeah, now we are seeing the screen.
Okay.
Your video is still frozen, Devendra and Professor Kulkarni. So, can I suggest something? Can you switch off the video and just keep the audio on? Maybe the internet is an issue, and you can try switching your video off and just speak with the shared screen.
Okay.
So audience members, there seems to be some technical issue on the speaker's side. So sorry, we have to bear with it. Let's wait for them to come back. Professor Kulkarni, can you hear me? If you can hear me, please unmute yourself, share the screen, and we can start the lecture.
Chandrasil, can you enable the screen sharing?
Yes, so I have enabled Professor Kulkarni's as a co-host, and he can share the screen now. He can try.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. Go ahead, please. Yeah.
So with this Kurosh type of philosophy, a subgroup of gamma is a free product of some number of copies, say E2, E sub 2 copies of Z2, E sub 3 copies of Z3, and say R copies of Z. So E2, E3, R, and also what possible index D the group may have. These are the intrinsic invariants of phi as a subgroup of finite index. The same abstract group can be realized as a subgroup of infinite index, but as a subgroup of finite index, that index has to be very fixed. And this is the abstract group theoretic topological characterization that is developed. Namely, the index is we define the Euler characteristic of gamma. Gamma is the modular group. It is computed as 1/2 plus 1/3 minus 1. This minus 1 is for there is only one free product symbol, and otherwise it is 1 over the order of the group. So this is minus 1 over 6. That is the Euler characteristic of the group gamma. And that of phi, if there are E2 copies of Z2, then that will contribute E2 by 2 plus E3 by 3. And the number of connections is E2 plus E3 plus R. And that minus 1, that is to be subtracted. Then the possible index of phi in gamma is Euler characteristic of phi minus divided by Euler characteristic of gamma. Now you see that Euler characteristic of phi is a rational number in this Wall Euler characteristic. Chi gamma is also a rational number, but the ratio of these rational numbers is an integer. And that integer is supposed to be at least one. It is a positive integer. And you see that this integer in this calculation, this does turn out to be 3e2 plus 4e3 plus 6r minus 1. Okay, now let me state the Millington's theorem that given these invariants, given these integers E2, E3, R, and D greater than or equal to 1, the others greater than or equal to 0, and if they satisfy star, then there does exist a group gamma of finite index having these invariants. This is the theorem of Millington, This is a weak form of the theorem of Millington. Millington was a student of, I think, Swinnerton, Dyer, and Aitkins, maybe. And so you see, with this, you can see in particular, this condition star is has some implications, namely Z2, Z3, Z2 star, Z2, and Z. They would not occur as subgroups of finite index in gamma. And these are the only such subgroups. This follows from just you do the ratio of the two Euler characteristics and require that that should be a positive integer. Now, the original and strong form of Millington's theorem was really in terms of surfaces, that E2 is the number of branch points of index 2, E3 is the branch points of index 3, and D is greater than or equal to 1. So if they satisfy star, namely that Euler characteristic condition, where I was using the word letter R there, R is supposed to be 2G plus T minus 1. If this is the case, then Millington was saying that there exists a subgroup gamma of finite index realizing this invariance of the corresponding modular curve. E2 is the number of branch points of order 2, E3 is the number of branch points of order 3, and genus and the cusps. So this was the original theorem. So you will realize that the star is really a form of the classical Riemann-Hurwitz formula in the context of modular curves. And Millington's theorem answers a series of questions posed by another worker in this field, H. Peterson. And the method, the actual method Millington followed was relating existence of a subgroup of index D to existence of certain permutations in the symmetric group sigma sub D and finding these permutations explicitly. So it's a very algebraic and a fairly long proof, but now we can give the topological version of this. How much time do I have?
30 more minutes.
Oh, very good, very good. 15 minutes. Okay, so to explain the idea, let me take a more general case. Let me take a free product of two cyclic groups, two finite cyclic groups, Z mod N1 and Z mod N2, and take its free product. Now, by the Grosch philosophy, any of its subgroup has this structure, namely F sub a free group of rank R and some Z sub mu. So mu is some divisor of either N1 or N2, and so on. So this is a structure of any subgroup of gamma. Now here I just detailed, I explained what L equals 0 means, etc. I do not take this now. Now let R be equal to write 2H plus S minus 1. So another H invariants H and S. S is like the number of cusps and H is like the genus. Necessary and sufficient condition that phi can be realized as a subgroup of finite index D, genus H, and number of ends or cusps is S, if and only if mu should divide N1 or N2, and this is the Euler characteristic condition of this group. And this 1 over N1 plus 1 over N2 minus 1 is the Euler characteristic of gamma. And so this Euler characteristic should be D times this Euler characteristic. These are the obvious necessary conditions. But in addition, there arises a Diophantine system. So let M1, M2, ML be the maximal set of distinct MUs. And each MQ, let that occur BQ times. And delta IQ be ni divided by mq, then this divergence is indeterminate. X1q and x2q, these are two divergent conditions, and we want a solution of xi sub q in non-negative integers, and if xiq is zero, if mq does not divide ni, and so on. Okay, now I explain the topological proof. Then we now construct a space with fundamental group n1 z mod n1 and another space with fundamental group z mod n2 and connect it by the actual physical rod. Now, corresponding to a subgroup of gamma, there will be a covering, a connected covering of that space. Now, this connected covering of the space, how is it built up? So you take the connected coverings of the left-hand part, whose fundamental group is Z mod N1. This is my space X. And on the right-hand side, you see B edges with fundamental group Z mod N2 by B. So if I take this right-hand blob with one arm, that will be lifted to some bigger blob with B edges. And similarly, on the left-hand side. And so my covering is built out of these building blocks, and where each left side arm is connected to one and only one right side arm, and so on. So, and the you can see the divergence condition is really the formalization of constructing a connected diagram. So this covering should be connected. So that divergence condition is really the formulation of the connectedness condition. Okay, this is the general case. Now, what happens in Millington's case is if n1 equals 2 and n2 equals 3, these are co-prime. And so Millington's theorem will be true also when I take n1 and n2, any pair of co-prime primes. So it turns out that the divergence condition is a consequence of the first two conditions. And that is the interesting part here in Millington's theorem. And so we shall do this directly by means of pictures. We again construct this space X mod gamma. This is an abstract space. I think I said it before. So the any covering. Yeah. I take two topological spaces with fundamental group Z mod 2 and with fundamental group Z mod 3. You can, if you like, you can take the real projective plane as the space with fundamental group Z mod 2 and some lens, three-dimensional lens space as a fundamental group Z mod 3 and just connect them by this rod. So what these actual spaces are is no more important. So I just denote this symbolically that this P and L, these will be the two block of type 1, and L is the three block of type 1. Now the connected coverings of this X will be obtained by these only four blocks of this type. Yeah. Now, we get a connected picture. Again, I'm repeating here. So suppose phi has E2 copies of Z2 and E3 copies of Z3 and R copies of Z, then we need E2, respectively E3 copies of two blocks of type 1, respectively three blocks of type 1, and D minus E2 by 2 copies of two blocks of type 2, and D minus E3 by 3 blocks of type 2. And to get a connected diagram, now you just first concentrate on the three blocks. So the number of three blocks is E3 plus D minus E3 by 3. The E3 blocks have only one arm, D minus E3 blocks have three arms. So these are the number of arms. So the number of arms is really D, the total number of arms. But the blocks are D minus E3 by 3 plus E3. Now these three blocks can be connected. Now if these three blocks are to be connected, then some arm of one of the three blocks is to be connected with some arm of the some other three blocks. Now you see, among the two blocks of type one cannot do that job because it has only one edge and it can go to the only single right edge to the three block. So what we need is that we should have two blocks of type two should be at least, these are the number of components on the right hand side, minus one, or the difference should be greater than or equal to zero. Now, if you see this condition, this and multiply by six, then you get the condition D minus 3E2, or let me take this terms on the right hand side, then D equals 3E2 plus 4E3 equals 6R minus 6. So D equals 3E2 plus 4E3 plus 6R minus 1. So by the condition start, Euler characteristic condition, and there in the Euler characteristic condition, R is greater than or equal to 0. So this inequality is satisfied. So we can construct a connected diagram, and that would correspond to a subgroup phi of gamma. So this is the weak form of Millington's theorem. I think diagram is great. Okay, by the way, some of you may have seen this Rankine's book on modular forms, and he has devoted one full chapter on subgroups of low index, subgroups of gamma of low index up to six. And he describes in detail, this description is algebraic. And to that whole discussion, we can associate these pictures and you get some understanding. You get some different understanding. Now, this is the weak form of Millington's theorem. But now I have to realize the genus and the cusp. And here is the surface topology comes in. Now, I have thickened these arms and created this space. So except for this two and three, the whole thing is topologically a disk. I explained this before. And now the possible connected covering that we are allowing of the left part is either itself or its twofold covering. And the left part, either it itself or its threefold covering. So these are the building blocks of the of your connected covering, which are the modular curves, where the cusps are taken off. Now, let's just for simplicity, the thickened edge I call an arm. And now some surface topology has to come in. There is a border on the edges of each of the diagrams and also on the arms of the thickening. Now you take all these blocks, possible blocks that you have in here, and actually physically put them in the plane. Can you hear me?
Professor Kulkarni, we can hear, there is some disturbance ongoing. So maybe this slide you can repeat. It will be better if you repeat the last couple of minutes part.
Hello, Chandrasil.
Hello.
Hello.
Who is this?
Everything is fine. I'm Devendra.
No, we are not able to hear Professor Kulkarni at all. No.
No, no, I am not speaking yet. I'm speaking now. Can you hear
me? Okay, so yeah, now I can hear you. I hope you can hear us, and you can just repeat this slide again. What you started from this slide, at the beginning of this slide.
Slides are visible, no?
Yes, they are visible.
Oh, so you got this picture, right? So these are the four building blocks by which I am going to construct the given modular curve where cusps are cut off. That is, I'm going to build this. So now I put all these thickened diagrams in the plane. And let me try to construct a surface of genus zero first with the with that proper satisfying the Euler characteristic. Now that we can actually embed that in R2. Now this is, we have a compact surface with boundary, and if I can embed that with R3, satisfying that relation, then I have to get this connected diagram. Now consider these three blocks, either of type 1 or type 2, and we start connecting the arms of these three blocks with those of two blocks in pairs, so that we do not introduce any intersections. You know, this is the Jordan Kerr theorem, that two circles can intersect only transversely in even number of points. Also, I try to introduce no intersections. So I shall get something of genus zero. And we go on reducing the number of connected components as quickly as possible until we are left with exactly one component, one connected component. Now let us call the new complex obtained this way by D0. Now D0 is topologically closed disk, but it has this 2R plus 2E2 right arms, which remain to be connected with the same number of left arms of the two blocks. The unconnected arms of D0 have a well-defined cyclic order. And so are the arms of the two blocks, which remain to be connected. So using these cyclic orders, it is possible to connect the remaining arms in D0 with those of three blocks, so that in this process, no intersections are introduced. So this can be done. And so in this way, I get a thickened diagram for a subgroup pi of index D, which has genus zero. So I constructed a genus zero surface properly. And now the number of cusps, or which I call the S, that is there, in the paper I call them ends. So there are R plus one, S equals R plus one boundary components for this surface of genus zero. Now this X phi naught is obtained from the disk G naught, which has only one boundary component, by attaching some two blocks, and in the process, it produces R extra boundary components. Now I will realize the H and T. T is the same as S. So if R is less than or equal to 1, then H is 0, and there is nothing to prove. If R is greater than 2, then this S, the number of cusps is at least 3. But now these cusps are represented by these circles, boundary circles. And it is an elementary fact from the topology of surfaces that as long as S is greater than or equal to 3, we can interchange two connections of an appropriate pair of arms, which reduces S by 2 and increases the genus by one. And this way, the proof is finished. Okay. So this is the original Millington theorem. Now, in that paper, she considers the problem of cusp widths. So let me explain that. So cusp width is, you see, the cusps are defined geometrically. These are the punctures. But now to each such puncture, we have associated a circle. And these circles are the boundary circles. And these boundary circles are covering this basic modular curve. And this boundary circle will go to the boundary of this basic dumbbell type of shape, modular curve. And the obvious condition, the degree of the, if I take one boundary component above and project it below, so it's some d sub I fold covering. And that d sub I is exactly what is classically called the cusp width. And of course, the sum of all the cusp widths is the total degree of the covering, which is d. So Millington considered the problem whether the partition of d into t components, so d equals d1 plus d2, etc., up to d sub t, such a partition of numbers, she calls the cusp split. And she asked whether every such cusp split is realizable. She also observed that there exist some cusp splits which are not realizable. But she kind of considered a conjecture that if the index is large enough, so given does there exist an integer n? So if the index is greater than n, then any partition of d into t parts, there exists a group of this type with this cusp split. Now, we give a counterexample to this conjecture, and we have worked it out only in the last 2 weeks, and we have a better understanding of the cusp width problem. And let's call this cusp width problem, which partitions of d into t parts can be realized by the cusp widths. So, how much time is
there? There are 10 minutes, yeah.
Okay, let me see the picture.
You want to see the picture?
Yeah. Yeah, so this modular curve corresponding to phi topologically would look like this. This is where the cusps are cut off. And here is some genus. And this is below. I have to draw below. So my basic modular curve, there is no genus. And there is only one cusp. And there is this projection mapping of this type. Here is some genus. and these are the boundary curves. And suppose there are three curves, and this boundary goes is the degree of this, just one component is say d1. So you know, d1 plus d2 plus d sub t, these are the degrees of the component covering the circle, and this should be equal to d. And so our problem is to see which of these this is the cusp split, which of the cusp splits are realized. So we took the groups of genus zero and which are torsion free, and we started computing those cusp split, and we see that the at least two of the summands, at most two of the summands can be one, and other summands are even, or all summands can be even. These are the only two types of torsion-free genus zero surfaces. And so not all cusp splits are possible. That is clear from this result. And we also see exactly how the cusp splits in general can be computed. I would like to know if someone knows about this gets related with tiling a closed disk. Let me draw another picture. Yeah, so I think there is some Catalan numbers or something. So can I tile? So all such tiles with T tiles. So how many such tiles exist, etc., etc. And I think there is some interesting number theory about this problem. So we are still exploring that. And if possible, I think we could arrange some kind of tutorial lesson on computing these cusp splits. This seems to be a reasonable problem which could be possibly pursued and published in a paper. Okay, thank you.
So thank you, Professor Kulkarni, for a wonderful talk. Are there some questions from the audience members? So Professor Kulkarni, a general question. So how about the other higher dimensional hyperbolic spaces? Are there some is a similar theory expected there of triangle groups and so on?
Higher dimensionals, or what do you mean?
So for example, three dimensional hyperbolic space, and one gets like.
You see, underlying topology becomes complicated. Here we are. Mm-hmm. We are using classification of surfaces.
Hmm.
And really, if you know the proofs of the classification of surfaces, you will see some of these constructions. So I think these methods, one has to be someone like Thurston, like genius to see how these other things would be connected, things like that. Yeah.
Okay.
But in this classical case, I think I would suggest you you consider all literature. So these modular curves are connected with the, these are some branched Riemann surfaces. And so particularly important among them is the congruous modular curve. Mm. That is, whose fundamental group contains some gamma sub n, gamma n. So there are some sub coverings of the group with the transformation group is PSL 2 Z mod n.
Okay.
So the number three problems are the, in those cases, compute what are the possible cusp weights. Mm-hmm. So they're again very special. And some number theory also comes in there. Yeah, in the same way, I think it was my good fortune to tackle, I was able to tackle another problem in this area, namely to actually draw the fundamental domains, good fundamental domains for all subgroups of the modular group. Yeah, hello.
Yeah, go ahead. Professor Kulkarni, we are losing the image. So if you wanted to show us some PDF,
I passed that. I just remarked that the actually constructing the fundamental domains has some other geometry, and hyperbolic geometry comes in there, and some very interesting connections with the number theory of fairy fractions. This classical number theory that comes in a very interesting way. So I shall eventually discuss that sometime.
Sure.
So for this, Devendra was saying that we could have some tutorial on this. Devendra himself would like to talk. Let me tell you this.
Saturday, I think, for the tutorials. Saturdays.
We will meet at Saturday.
I'll just request if there are some questions, we can take it first. Otherwise, once we're done with the YouTube broadcast, we can discuss a few things about the
future
lectures. Yeah, sorry.
No, for this YouTube thing, let me say that I shall still work on the slides and send those slides to you later.
Sure.
Okay.
So, Science Media Center representative, we are requesting you to stop the YouTube broadcast now. We can.